Welcome to Ideas in Action, the official University of Southern California podcast. This show was recorded live on USC's campus.
I'm Lee Hopper, interviewing Dr. Maria Aranda for USC News. Dr. Aranda is a professor in the School of Social Work at USC, and her focus is Latinos and Alzheimer's disease. And we're talking about the fact that Latinos are the largest minoritized group in the United States, about 19% of the population. But for various reasons, they represent only a tiny, tiny part of the people recruited into clinical trials for Alzheimer's disease. So you have a new paper out. It's about a micro, meso, macro framework for diversifying Alzheimer trial recruitment. Tell me about that title. What do you mean by micro, meso, macro?
I know it's a lot to say in one breath. Well, we have a very we have a significant public health problem here in the U.S., and that's the fact that the numbers of people with memory problems, specifically Alzheimer's disease and related disorders, those specific types of disorders that are called neurocognitive disorders, and place a significant burden on individuals and families that live with these disorders. And Alzheimer's happens to be the one that is most prevalent of all the neurocognitive disorders. But we know that with the aging of the population, not only in the U.S., but in the world, we're going to see more and more cases, more and more individuals that are going to have to live with Alzheimer's disease and related dementias. What's has been quite significant in the last maybe 30, maybe going on 40 years, is the scientific community has embarked on trying to find that specific drug that will either prevent these disorders, cure these disorders, or delay their progression. The fly in the ointment is that in the last 40 years, the clinical studies that have been put forward to test different types of pharmacological agents of all types have been primarily tested on samples that fail to include ethnic and racial minoritized populations and other populations, but let's focus on racial and ethnic minoritized populations. And that's a problem. So less than 5%, if you look at all the studies that have been done and precisely more recently, less than 5% have included these populations. And that is a predicament, because if you're looking at identifying the etiology or the cause of memory loss, like Alzheimer's, like multi-infarct dementia, or what we call now vascular dementia and other types, if we look at trying to identify and pinpoint etiology or cause, we're hampered by the fact that we are only looking at certain types of populations and really dismissing, not including other populations. And that can be problematic because you may be missing certain etiologies or combination of etiologies that make a difference for those populations that have been excluded from representation in clinical trials. A corollary to that is that some medications, and this is a hypothesis, let's say a medication is identified as probably a potential drug agent, right, for these cognitive disorders. But we don't know if those particular drugs are as effective for the people that have been excluded from these clinical trials. And that's right. Problematic because, number one, they could have more adverse effects or the same adverse effects, or they may have no significant efficacy or the same efficacy, but we don't know yet because the evidence thus far has excluded these populations. Mm-hmm. And in particular, when you look at groups such as the Latino population in the United States, they are at increased risk for, let's say, Alzheimer's. And if so, and for other types of neurocognitive disorders. And if this is true, then we are missing the boat, so to speak. And we're really doing a disservice, because if they are one and a half times more likely to have Alzheimer's in their lifetime, then, you know, these are the types of people who we should be focusing on. Unfortunately, they're less likely also to get care. So when they do get care, they're delayed in their care, meaning they're more likely further into their disease than other groups.
Right. So in your paper, you make a series of pretty strongly worded proposals about how this should change. A couple of things that popped out at me looking at the paper was how so many clinical trials operate on an assumption that everybody has medical insurance. And then there's another assumption, and I'm curious about what the answer is to this issue, is there's an assumption of literacy. And when you're looking at a Latino population, there's a large percentage that don't have reading and writing skills, but who could benefit, we could all benefit by their inclusion in a clinical trial. So can we jump to these ideas about micro, meso, and macro interventions? Maybe tell me one of your top ones, and then we can talk a little bit into the background of why you are making that proposal.
Okay. Let's see here. I'm going to the list because, you know, as you know, we have a long list, right?
Yeah, I bookmarked that. That's towards the end of your study.
Okay, well, one of them, for example, is, I and my co-authors are very, very happy that the Federal Drug Administration put out what they call guidance documents to the trial community, a clinical trial community. And in those diversity plans, they highlighted, you know, specifically that they want to see that clinical trials incorporate plans that diversify their sample pool, their participant pool. And we think that that's important, and it's a sign and an indicator of an important path forward. But we want to make those plans binding. We want to make sure that that type of thinking is sustained over time, and that scientists and investigators and all types of other stakeholders understand that you have to diversify the sample pool. And so we'd like to see that the FDA actually enforce these diversity plans in the future for any types of trials that are going to be done. Otherwise, they shouldn't be approved.
How would they do that? Do you think that they should, when you submit your paperwork for a study, you should have a budget for diversifying your trial?
Absolutely. Whether it's you're submitting your plans to the FDA, or you're submitting a scientific proposal to the National Institutes of Health or to other large funders, you should have a diversity plan that makes sense, a recruitment plan that really makes sense. And it should make sense conceptually, operationally, but also financially. There has to be enough financial oomph in that plan to make the recruitment plausible, to make it real.
What are you paying for in those cases? What are some line items? I'm thinking, like, you've got to hire bilingual people. for instance.
Oh, absolutely. That'd probably be the first item to put there is to hire people who are bilingual and bicultural and have a good sense of the research enterprise or can be trained quickly. You can train people who are Spanish speaking, for example, bilingual. You can train them in the research enterprise. And I've done that in many different scientific projects. That's not difficult. What is difficult is trying to train people that know about the research enterprise, how to conduct trials, et cetera, but trying to teach them to interact with people who may have limited English speaking capabilities. So that budget should include hiring bilingual and bicultural. And I highlight the word bicultural because it's not enough to be a Spanish speaking research personnel, but you also have to understand the cultural nuances that are embedded in the communities in which you are doing recruitment. And in my projects, for example, I have a very robust training program that not only trains my personnel on the research process and protocols from A to Z, but also we have training that really looks at the specifics of working with Latino participants in terms of their cultural beliefs, their values, their customs, forms of communication, and types of words that can be utilized to explain things like memory loss, Alzheimer's, neuropsychological symptoms, these kinds of things, which may be difficult for any group, let's face it, because they are technical terms. But being able to translate them in ways that people can say, ah, I know what is meant by that.
Right. It's like you need a vocabulary at your fingertips or at your tongue in order to work with. I think also in your paper, you mentioned how in the Latino community, there's an expectation of a certain kind of behavior that sort of engenders trust. I can't remember what the word was. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Yes, it's the word personalismo. Personalismo, that's one of the words that was in the article. And really it's that sense of warmth and approachability that exuded by the individual that connects with others. And it helps in establishing that sense of trust. And I'm not saying that in any way, shape, or form that Latinos have a monopoly on that need to establish trust. But because of different forces and different historical contexts, that development of trust is even more pronounced in this community. And personalismo is something that we can help bring it out of our staff in order to be able to establish that sense of warmth, of welcoming and trust with our participants. And we have different exercises that we use to develop that type of behavior.
Well, that totally makes sense to me because I mean, all of us, when we're interacting with people who come to our door selling us something or who answer the phone when we call about something, you know, we can be turned off by an attitude. Or, you know, the opposite can happen where we feel engaged, we feel like the person cares, and that makes all the difference.
Even if it's on the phone, like you said, even if it's on the phone, their tone of voice, the inflection in their voice, the words that they use, the time they spend. And when a family member, when a person is going through this process of memory loss, it's very scary. It's very foreign. And even for caregivers who may be experiencing this, but from another point of view, it's something that they don't understand, they don't know about. So being able to exude that and connect with the person is important for everyone, but very much important for the Latino community when they try to engage with research personnel or even providers and human service professionals in the community.
So there was another item that I thought was interesting, and I'm curious what the workaround is that you suggest for it. And that is, clinical trials are very, very expensive. Yeah, the federal government provides a lot of grant funding for them. The pharmaceutical company does too. But yet at the nuts and bolts level, a lot of times there's a reliance on private insurance to pay for some of the, you know, aspects of, like, say, the routine visit where people come in to be evaluated or to be given an experimental medicine. Given that reliance, how would it work to enroll people that don't have private insurance in a clinical trial?
That sure is a sticky point, Lee, because if the trial in any way depends on health insurance to pay for all or for some or for one type of research activity or a visit, then that's going to be problematic. That's going to be problematic for anyone. Now, for Latinos in general, they are least likely of any group to have a regular point of medical care. So that means that they may not be connected as a group. They are less likely to be connected to a primary care provider, and less likely even with the health reform insurance availability, are less likely to avail themselves of health insurance in the public market. So if that's true, then you're going to get less participation of this group. And so one of the issues that we bring up in our article is the fact that if you're expecting for that to be seamless and for people to just cough up medical or healthcare insurance for any one or several research activities in your trial, then you're setting yourself up. Second, and this to me was something that I have seen more and more all the time, and it's also listed in the article, is that what do you do? What do you do if you identify, or you have the person, let's say the research study, identified a certain finding that you have, maybe the gene that is, you know, APOE4, or that you have an incidental finding that they happen to find, like, you know, a mass. What happens? What do you do? Is there follow-up care? Is there a very distinct protocol from the research study that says we will report out our findings in this way? We will attempt to refer and connect the individual with follow-up care. That's important to me. And that's important to my co-authors. So we want to make sure to identify, it's not just healthcare coverage or being able to avail oneself of a research study participation, but if something occurs and there's a finding, a negative finding, a finding that should be attended to, rather, that there is some way to connect the individual for some type of aftercare. And I'm concerned about that. Yeah. I doubt if that's happening.
I hadn't even thought about that. And that would be awful, where you think you're just evaluating somebody for cognitive loss, and then you find out that, you know, you suspect they have lung cancer or, you know, some other serious illness and they have no medical home. So you, the provider, what are you going to do about that? So something, right, needs to be built in.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And that's one of my big concerns. So, you know, funding is the issue, making sure that the recruitment and retention plan in your study application or your trial application is robust enough to cover what is really needed in the long haul. For example, I have a caregiver study right now that is active. We're in our first year, closing out our first year, going to our second year. And we are actively looking for caregivers of people that are living with dementia, family caregivers. And I know that I have to put up a sizable amount of money at the beginning to be able to recruit. And we're talking about thousands of dollars every month to recruit my sample. And my sample is multi-racial and multi-ethnic. English and Spanish. So I know that I have to put the resources up front. Fortunately, the state of California Department of Public Health did okay my recruitment budget. They okayed it, they approved it, because they know that it's important to get a diverse population, especially during now the post-pandemic era.
Was so your budget high?
Pardon me?
Was your budget high? I'm just curious why there might have been a question about them approving it.
Well, it's $1 million budget. It's not a small budget. It's $1 million budget for about a year and a half, something like that. Maybe a year and 8 months. And so they knew the importance of this, and they put their money where their mouth is. They understood it, and they approved my recruitment plan and the funds that went with it. But they knew that this was an important thing to do. They knew that it was going to take resources, and they approved it. So it has to be robust enough, and you can't have just one person out there the lone wolf doing the recruitment. Usually that person, it's not enough. They get burned out and you don't meet your recruitment diversity goals.
You know, another thing that I think a lot of people don't think about that's unique to Alzheimer's and maybe some other neurocognitive problems is that the people come in pairs, at least. You never recruit just the patient. There's also a caregiver, right? Because the patient may be at a different stage of advancement of the disease. You need the caregiver to kind of give their perspective on what's going on. Is that, I mean, it seems like that would make it even more expensive.
Well, it depends on the focus of your study, right? Your study maybe focuses on persons living with early cognitive impairment. These individuals may not even have a caregiver and may not even want to caregive it because they're not at the point in their life where they feel they need one. And so caregiving is an interesting phenomenon. We could have a whole other discussion about that. But different types of caregivers may be, how would I say, activated in the trajectory of the cognitive condition. But if you do include caregivers as well in your study, then yes, you're looking now at another aim, another objective of your study. So that by default will increase the funding line. But I want to go back to this framework, the micro, meso, macro framework that you identified earlier. As you can see from what we're talking about, in order to be able to recruit higher numbers of Latinos in Alzheimer's disease and related disorders, in terms of these projects, clinical trials rather, we have to be able to look at three levels, the micro level. For example, we have the discussion right now about personalism and that sense of warmth and trust that is exuded from the person when they interact with the individual to explain what is the study all about, research participation, what it means to the individual, to society, et cetera, and to be able to field any type of questions they may have. But the second layer is the meso. And we also talked about that, you know, making sure that we have bilingual and bicultural staff, making sure that the protocols, the study trial protocols, don't exclude Latinos just by a mere fact that they put English only, or that they have to be able to read English. That would already exclude a significant number of Latinos from that particular study. But then there's the macro or structural barrier level. Meso level is also structural. Because in the literature in the last maybe, I would say 20 to 30 years maybe, most of the attention was paid on the micro level. Like, what is it about the person and the family member and their culture that acts as a barrier in getting into a clinical trial or an observational study, let's say, any study? It doesn't have to be a trial. So the onus was always put on the individual or the family member. And really, this is not the way to go. So what we did is we got a, you know, all of us are experts in this area. We've had lived experience working in the scientific field, as well as working with the Latino population. And we thought, you know, a lot of these upstream factors, these structural factors, whether it's at the agency level, the study protocol level, or structural levels. For example, we mentioned FDA a little while ago, Federal Drug Administration, the National Institutes of Health. What type of procedures, processes, regulations do they have that act as barriers to Latino present participation in clinical trials? And that's what we were trying to really look at. And those are the barriers that are upstream that have really a very direct and significant and widespread influence on how trials get rolled out and the diversification of their trial samples.
Well, and at that macro level, I think you mentioned in the paper is diversity among leadership itself, right? At the FDA and the NIH.
FDA, NIH, healthcare systems. We know that Latinos make a very small proportion of the executive workforce that makes high level decisions. So this is very important to be able to change that, you know, to move the needle and explore ways that the workforce itself can be diversified. For example, I'm a Latina, I have a PhD, I'm a scientist, I'm the needle in the haystack, and I work in the fields of aging and Alzheimer's. So I'm the leader, needle in the haystack. and that's got to change because I've been saying that for years. So we want to make sure that, you know, the scientists that do this work and have lived experience in this community also are able to be in these rooms where decisions are made at the higher level.
So with that, I want to clarify that in addition to being a needle in the haystack, you are also a professor of social work and gerontology. You're the executive director of the Roybal Institute on Aging?
Yes. I'm the executive director of the Edward R. Roybal Institute on Aging.
Right. Okay. All right. Well, and you are based in the USC Suzanne Dworak-Peck School of Social Work.
Exactly. I'm a professor there, and I've been there a number of years.
Well, this was such a pleasure talking to you. Any last minute words that you'd like to add before we close out?
Well, I'm looking forward to receiving comments from my peers regarding this article. And I'm sure it's going to be the source of a lot of debate in the next few months, weeks and months, which I think is important. Many times in order to be able to take a path forward, we have to take that first foot forward, right? To be able to, you know, really elucidate some of the potential barriers that we're seeing in the field at the present time.
Well, thank you so much, Maria. I hope you have a great weekend.
Thank you. It's been a pleasure, like always. Thank you so much.
Okay, you take care. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Thanks for listening. Be sure to subscribe to our podcast and visit us at podcasts.usc.edu.